Divina Commedia of Dante Alighieri. The Inferno. Canto 1. In middle of the journey of our days, I found that I was in a darksome wood, the right road lost and vanished in the maze. Oh me, how hard to make it understood, how rough that wood was, wild and terrible. By the mere thought my terror is renewed. More bitter scars were death, but here I tell, at large of good which there by me was found, I will relate what other things befell. Scarce know I how I entered on that ground, so deeply at the moment when I passed, from the right way was I in slumber drowned. But when beneath a hill arrived at last, which for me boundary of the valley stood, that with such terror had my heart harassed, I upwards looked, and saw its shoulders glowed, radiant already with that planet's light, which guideth surely up on every road. A little then was quieted by the sight, the fear which deep within my heart had lain, through all my sore experience of the night. And as the man who, breathing short in pain, had scaped the sea and struggled to the shore, turns back to gaze upon the perilous main, even so my soul, which fear still forward bore, turned to review the pass whence I egressed, and which none living ever left before. My wearied frame, refreshed with scanty rest, I to ascend the lonely hill essayed, the lower foot still that on which I pressed, and lo, ere I had well beginning made. A nimble leopard light upon her feet, and in a skin all spotted o'er arrayed, nor sees she ever me full in the face to meet, and to me in my path such hindrance true, that many a time I willed me to retreat. It was the hour of dawn with retinue of stars that were with him when love divine in the beginning into motion drew those beauteous things, the sun began to shine. And I took heart to be of better cheer, touching the creature with the gaudy skin, seeing 'twas morn and springtide of the year, yet not so much but that when into sight a lion came, I was disturbed with fear. Towards me he seemed advancing in his might, rabid with hunger and with head high thrown. The very air was tremulous with fright. A she-wolf, too, beheld I further on. All kinds of lust seemed in her leanness pent. Through her, ye now, much folk have misery known. By her oppressed, and altogether spent, by the terror breathing from her aspect fell, I lost all hope of making the ascent. And as the man who joys while thriving well, when comes the time to lose what he has won, in all his thoughts weeps inconsolable, so mourned I through the brood which rest knows none. She barred my way again and yet again, and thrust me back where silent is the sun. And as I downward rushed to reach the plain, before mine eyes appeared there one aghast, and dumb like those that silence long maintain, when I beheld him in the desert vast. Whatever thou art or goest to man, I cried, I pray thee show such pity as thou hast. No man thought once I was, on either side, Lombard my parents were, and both of them, for native place had Mantua, he replied. Though late, Sabulio, to the world I came, and lived at Rome in good Augustus day, while yet false gods and lying were supreme. Poet I was, renowning in my lay, and Caesar's righteous song who fled from Troy. What time-proud alien was to flames a prey? But though, why going back to such annoy? The hill delectable why fear to mount? The origin and ground of every joy. And though in sooth art Virgil and the fount, whence in a stream so full doth language flow, abashed, I answered him with humble front. Of other poets, light and honour though, let the long study and great zeal have shown, in searching well thy book, awhelm me now. My master though, and author though, alone, from thee alone I, borrowing, could attain the style consummate which has made me known. Behold the beast which makes me turn again. Deliver me from her, illustrious sage, because of her I tremble, pulse and wane. Thou must attempt another pilgrimage. Observing that I wept, he made reply, if from this waste thyself thou'st disengage. Because the beast thou art afflicted by will suffer none along her way to pass, but hindering them harasses till they die. So wild a nature and corrupt she has, her raging lust is still insatiate, and food but makes it fiercer than it was. Many a creature hath she ta'en for mate, and more she'll wed until the hound comes forth to slay her and afflict with torment great. He will not batten upon pelf or earth, but he shall feed on valour, love and lore. Feltro and Feltro twin shall be his birth. He will save humbled Italy and restored, for which of old virgin Camilla died, Turnus, Euryalus, Nisus died of yore, her through all cities chasing far and wide. He at the last to hell will thrust her down, whence envy first unloosed her, I decide. Therefore, and judge that thou hadst best come on with me for guide, and hence I'll lead thee where a place eternal shall to thee be shown. There shalt thou hear the howlings of despair, in which the ancient spirits make lament, all of them fain the second death to share. Next shalt thou them behold who are content, because they hope some time, though now in fire, to join the blessed, they will win consent. And if to this, though later wilt aspire, a soul shall guide thee worthier far than I. When I depart thee, will I live with her, because the emperor who reigns on high will snort since gainst his loss I did rebel, that to his city I bring any nigh. O'er all the world he rules, there reigns as well. There is his city, an exalted seat. O happy whom he chooses there to dwell. And I to him, poet, I thee entreat, even by that God who was to thee unknown, that I may escape this present ill, no meet with worse, conduct me whither thou hast shown, that I may see St. Peter's gate and those whom thou reportst in such misery thrown. He moved away, behind him held I close. Canto 2. It was the close of day, the twilight brown. All living things on earth was setting free from toil, while I preparing was alone to face the battle which awaited me. As well of Ruth as of the perilous quest, now to be limned by faultless memory, help, lofty genius, muses manifest, goodwill to me, recording what befell, Do thou, O mind, now show thee at thy best. I thus began, poet and guide as well, ere trusting me on this adventure wide. Judge if my strength of it be capable. Thou say'st that Sylvia's father, ere he died, still mortal, to the world immortal went, there in the body some time to abide. Yet that the foe of evil was content that he should come, seeing what high effect, and who and what, should from him clay descend. No room for doubt can thoughtful man detect, for he of noble Rome and of her sway, imperial, in high heaven grew sire elect. And both of these, the very truth to say, were founded for the holy seat whereon the greater Peter's follower sits today. Upon this journey, praised by thee, were known, and heard things by him to which he ought. His triumph, whence derives the papal gown, that path the chosen vessel later trod, so of the faith assurance to receive, which is beginning of salvation's road. But why should I go? Who will sanction give? For I am no Aeneas and no Paul. Me worthy of it, no one can believe, nor I myself. Hence venturing at thy call, I dread the journey may prove rash, but vain, for me to reason, wise, thou know'st it all. Like one no more for what he wished for fain, whose purpose shapes mutation with his thought, till from the thing begun he turns again. On that dim slope so grew I all distraught, because by brooding on it the design I shrank from, which before I warmly sought. If well I understand these words of thine, the shade of him magnanimous made reply, thy soul neath cowardice had sunk supine, which a man often is so burdened by. It makes him falter from a noble aim, as beasts at objects ill-distinguished shy. To lose thee from this terror, why I came, and what this speech I heard, I will relate. When first of all I pitied thee, a dame held me where I amongst those in dubious state had my abode, so blessed was she and fair. Her to command me, I petitioned straight. Her eyes were shining brighter than the star, and she began to say in accents sweet and tunable as angels' voices are, O Mantuan shade, in courtesy complete, whose fame survives on earth, nor less shall grow through all the ages while the world hath seed. A friend of mine, with fortune for his foe, has met with hindrance on his desert way, and terror-smitten can no further go, but turns, and that he is too far astray. And that I rose too late for help I dread, from what in heaven concerning him they say. Go, with thy speech persuasive him bestead, and with all needful help his guardian prove, that touching him I may be comforted. No, it is Petrus seeks thee thus to move. Thence come I, where I to return am fain. My coming and my plea are ruled by love. When I shall stand before my Lord again, often to him I will renew thy praise. And here she ceased, nor did I dumb remain, O virtuous lady, though alone the race, of man exaltest above all else that dwell beneath the heaven which wills in narrowest space. To do thy bidding pleases me so well, though 'twere already done 'twere all too slow, thy wish at greater length no need to tell. But say, what tempted thee to come thus low, even to this centre from the region vast, whither again thou art on fire to go? This much to learn, since a desire thou hast. She answered, briefly thee I'll satisfy. Now coming here, I through no terrors passed. We are, of right, such things alarmed by, as have the power to hurt us all beside, are harmless and not fearful. Wherefore I, thus formed by God, his bounty is so wide, am left untouched by all your miseries, and through this burning unmolested glide. A noble lady is in heaven who sighs o'er the obstruction where'd have thee go, and breaks the rigid edict of the skies. Calling on Lucia, thus she made her know what she desired. Thy vassal now hath need of help from thee, do thou then helpful show. Lucia, who hates all cruelty, in speed rose, and approaching where I sat at rest, to venerable Rachel giving heed, me, Beatrice, true praise of God addressed. Why not help him who had such love for thee, and from the vulgar throng to win thee pressed? Dost thou not hear him weeping pitiably, nor mark the death now threatening him upon a flood, that which less awful is the sea? Never on earth did any ever run, allured by profit or impelled by fear, swifter than I when speaking she had done. From sitting among the blessed descended here, my trust upon thy comely rhetoric cast, which honours thee and those who lend it ear. When of these words she spoken had the last, she turned aside bright eyes which tears did fill, and I by this was urged to greater haste, and so it was I joined thee by her will, and from that raging beast delivered thee, which barred the near way up this beauteous hill. What ails thee then? Why thus a laggard be? Why cherish in thy heart a craven fear? Where is thy franchise, where thy bravery, when three such blessed ladies have a care for thee in heaven's court, and these words of mine thee for such wealth of blessedness prepare? As flowers by chills nocturnal made to pine, and shut themselves when touched by morning bright, upon their stems arise full blown and fine, so of my faltering courage changed the plight, and such good cheer ran through my heart it spurred me to declare like freeborn generous wight. O pitiful, who for my succour stirred, and though how full of courtesy to run, alert in service, hearkening her true ward. Though with thine eloquence my heart hast won to keen desire to go, and the intent which first I held I now no longer shun. Therefore proceed, my will with thine is blent. Thou art my guide, Lord, Master, though alone, thus I, and with him as he forward went, the steep and rugged roads I entered on. Canto 3, Through me to the city dolorous lies the way. Who passed through me shall paint eternal proof. Through me enriched the people lost for aye. 'Twas justice did my glorious maker move. I was created by the power divine, the highest wisdom and the primal love. Nothing's creation earlier was than mine. If not eternal, I for aye endure, ye who make entrance every hope resign. These words beheld I read in hue obscure, on summit of a gateway, wherefore I, hard is their meaning, master, like one sure, beforehand of my thought he made reply. Here it behoves to leave all fears behind, all cowardice behoveth here to die. For now the place I told thee of we find, where though the miserable folk should see, whose a true good of reason have resigned. Then with a glance of glad serenity, he took my hand in his, which made me bold, and brought me in where secret things there be. Their sighs and plaints and wailings uncontrolled, the dim and starless air resounded through, nor at the first could I from tears withhold the various languages and words of woe, the uncouth accents mixed with angry cries, and smiting palms and voices loud and low, composed a tumult which doth circling rise, forever in that air obscured for aye, as when the sound upon the whirlwind flies. And horror-stricken, I began to say, Master, what sound can this be that I hear, and who the folk thus whelmed in misery? And he replied, In this condition drear, I held the souls of that inglorious crew, who lived unhonored, but from guilt kept clear. Mingled they are with caitiff angels who, though from avowed rebellion they refrained, disloyal to God, did selfish ends pursue. Heaven hurled them forth, lest they her beauty stained. Received they are, not by the nether hell, else triumph thence were by the guilty gained. And I, what bear they, master, to compel their lamentations in such grievous tone? He answered, In few words I will thee tell. No hope of death is to the wretches known. So dim the life and abject where they sigh, they count all sufferings easier than their own. Of them the world endures no memory. Mercy and justice them alike disdain. Speak we not of them, glance and pass them by. I saw a banner when I looked again, which always whirling round advanced in haste, as if despising steadfast to remain. And after it, so many people chased, in long procession I should not have said, that death had ever wrought such countless waste. Some first I recognized, and then the shade. I saw anew of him the search to close, whose dastard soul the great refusal made. Straightway I knew and was assured that those were of the tribe of caitiffs in the race, despised of God and hated of his foes. The wretches who then living showed no trace of life went naked and were fiercely stung by wasps and hornets swarming in that place. Blood drawn by this out of their faces sprung, and mingled with their tears was at their feet. Sucked up by loathsome worms it fell among. Casting mine eyes beyond of this replete, people I saw beside an ample stream, whereon I said, O master, I entreat, tell who these are, and by what law they seem, impatient till across the river gone, as I distinguish by this feeble gleam. And he, these things shall unto thee be known, what time our footsteps shall at rest be found, upon the woeful shores of Acheron. Then with ashamed eyes cast on the ground, fearing my words were irksome in his ear, until we reached the stream I made no sound. And toward us, lo, then a bark drew near, a veteran who, his ancient hair was white, shouting, Ye souls depraved, be filled with fear, hope nevermore of heaven to win the sight. I come to take you to the other strand, to frost and fire and everlasting night. And thou, O living soul, who there dost stand, from among the dead withdraw thee, then aware that not at all I stirred at his command, by other ways, from other ports thou'lt fare, but they will lead thee to another shore, and sith a skiff more buoyant must thee bear. And then my leader, Charon, be not sore, for thus it has been willed where Parvani came, short of the will, though therefore ask no more. And hereupon his shaggy cheeks grew tame. Who is the pilot of the livid pool, and round about whose eyes glowed wheels of flame? But all the shades, naked and spent with dew, stood chattering with their teeth and changing hue, soon as they heard the words unmerciful. God they blasphemed, and families whence they grew, mankind, the time, place, seed in which began their lives, and seed whence they were born. Then drew they crowding all together as they ran, bitterly weeping, to their cursed shore, predestined for every godless man. The demon Charon, with eyes evermore aglow, makes signals gathering them all, and whoso lingers smiteth with his oar, and as the faded leaves of autumn fall, one after the other till at last the bow sees on the ground spread all its coronal, with Adam's evil seed, so haps it know, at signs each falls in turn from off the coast, as fowls into the ambush fluttering go. The gloomy waters thus by them are crossed, and hereupon the further side they land, on this a new is gathering a host. Son, said the cautious master, understand, all such as in the wrath of God expire, from every country muster on this strand, to cross the river, they are all on fire, their wills by heavenly justice goaded on, until their terror merges in desire. This way no righteous soul has ever gone. Wherefore of thee, if Charon should complain, now art thou sure what by his words is shown. When he had uttered this, the dismal plain trembled so violently, my terror passed, recalling now, I'm bathed in sweat again. Out of the tearful ground there moaned a blast, whence lightning flashed forth red and terrible, which vanquished all my senses, and as cast in sudden slumber to the ground I fell. Canto 4. resounding thunder broke the slumber deep that drowsed my senses, and myself I shook, like one by force awakened out of sleep. Then rising up, I cast a steady look, with eyes refreshed, on all that lay around, and cognizance of where I found me took. In sooth, me on the valley's brink I found, of the dolorous abyss where infinite despairing cries converge with thundering sound. Cloudy it was, and deep, and dark as night, so dark that, peering eagerly to find what its depths held, no object met my sight. "Descend we now into this region blind," began the poet, with a face all pale. "I will go first, and do thou come behind." Marking the wanness on his cheek prevail, I asked, "How can I, seeing thou hast dread, my wonted comforter, when doubts assail the anguish of the people?" Then he said, "Who are below, has painted on my face pity by thee for fear interpreted. Come, the long journey bids us move apace, then entered here, and made me enter too, the topmost circle girding the abyss. Therein, as far as I by listening knew, there was no lamentation save of sighs, whence throve the air eternal through and through. This sorrow without suffering made arise from infants and from women and from men, gathered in great and many companies. And the good master, wouldst thou nothing then of who those spirits are have me relate? Yet now, here passing further, although when on earth they sinned not, what however great, avail them not, they being unbaptized. Part of the faith thou holdest, if their fate was to be born ere man was Christianized, God, as behoved, they never could adore, and I myself am with this folk comprised. For such defects, our guilt is nothing more. We are thus lost, suffering from this alone, that hopeless we our want of bliss deplore. Greatly I sorrowed when he made this known, because I knew that some who did excel in worthiness were to that limbo gone. "Tell me, O sir," I prayed him, "master, tell, that I of the belief might surety win, victorious every error to dispel. Did ever any hands to please attend?"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.